Hello everyone and welcome. I am super excited about this video. We're taking the stock exhaust out of my car. As you can see, it's out of the car and we're replacing it with this. This is a titanium exhaust. And the reason why I'm so excited is because this video is going to be packed with numbers, test data. And so we are going to be, you know, determining what's the weight difference between these two, what's the sound difference between these two, the actual decibel levels at different RPM, what's the horsepower difference between these two. We're going to be putting it on a dyno, and of course, real world testing. What is the actual difference in acceleration before and after putting this titanium exhaust on? Now, first off, a big thank you to AutoTempest.com. This is the final video of a three-part series where I've partnered with AutoTempest.com. I'll include a link in the video description. It's a super cool website, combines all of the different used car result websites into one website so you can just search in one location. Again, I'll have that link in the video description, and thank you to AutoTempest for supporting this channel. Now, this exhaust in front of me is what I would consider the holy grail of exhausts for Honda S2000s. This is the Amuse Euro S. It's a single muffler version. I went with a very similar style to the stock exhaust. Reason being is I didn't want it to be too loud. I think, you know, four cylinders aren't the greatest sounding engines in the world. They don't need to be accentuated any more than they are. So I wanted something that was still decently quiet, but significantly lighter. And this entire thing, this entire catback, is made out of titanium. It is a beautiful handcrafted, hand-built, custom order. Basically, when you put in the order is when they start making it. They don't just crank these things out. Each one is made individually for each customer. Very beautiful piece of work, which I ordered from Bulletproof Automotive. I mean, just look at these welds, how clean of a job they did with this. It's absolutely beautiful, and it's titanium. The whole thing is titanium, so super lightweight. Now, this is actually the same size diameter as the stock exhaust coming out of the catalytic converter, 60 millimeters. And the reason why I didn't go any larger, honestly, I don't think the catback is what's the restriction within the exhaust. That's really gonna come down to your catalytic converter. I don't plan on removing the catalytic converter, so I don't think it's really gonna be necessary to upgrade behind the catalytic converter. I think exhaust flow will be fine. Does that mean it can't make a power difference? No, absolutely not. So this has a much simpler routing, less bends in it, one single simple path rather than that splitting path and the more complicated routing within the mufflers. So we'll see. I'm looking forward to the testing to see if there's actually a difference in power between the two. So our first question, what is the weight difference between the two? Well, I weighed the stock exhaust. It came in exactly at 50 pounds. 50 pounds for just a catback exhaust. Then I weighed this titanium exhaust, full titanium catback, 15.8 pounds, 34.2 pounds saved. Pretty incredible that this exhaust right here is one third the weight of the stock exhaust, a little under a third of the weight of the stock exhaust. Even someone as scrawny as myself can move this thing around quickly. Look how lightweight this thing is. It's absolutely incredible. All right, so let's get started with the installation, and this is a pretty simple, straightforward process, so we're gonna go through this fairly quickly. First off, we're going to soak down the three exhaust nuts, which we're going to need to remove, and also spray some oil on the exhaust hangers because these can often be stubborn to remove as well. Next, we need to remove the suspension stiffener. There are six bolts that need to be removed to pull this off so that you can drop the exhaust out. Now we can start with the exhaust removal. First, starting with the three catback nuts. Remove these using a breaker bar if you need to, as they do tend to rust, and then pull the exhaust off the bolts and let it rest in place. From here, I work my way back, removing the exhaust hangers along the way. There are five in total, starting with the one underneath. Then there are two in each wheel well, and it can be helpful to remove your wheels to give yourself better access. Now, when these hangers are removed, the exhaust is quite heavy and will drop quickly. So to prevent damage, have some towels under it, or as you see here, I'm simply dropping it onto some old tires. Now, I decided to use new mounts since the ones on the car are 15 years old, but honestly, they seem to be in great shape, and I wouldn't be concerned about reusing them in their current state. There are different hardnesses used for these mounts, so if you do end up replacing them, be sure to buy the correct part numbers, which I'll have more info on in the video description. Installing the new exhaust is as simple as reversing your instructions. Place each of the rubber mounts on their respective hangers and slide the exhaust into place. Then mate up the exhaust to the catalytic converter bolts and torque the replacement nuts to 25 pound-feet or 33 newton meters. Finally, we can replace the suspension stiffener, torquing the four larger bolts to 33 pound-feet or 45 newton meters, and the two smaller screws to 7.2 pound-feet or 9.8 newton meters. Now at this point you'll notice there's an extra exhaust hanger, and I myself was a bit frustrated because I wasn't sure why it's welded on, but it turns out there was a piece sitting in the shipping box that I didn't notice. This bracket can be mounted with the rear differential mounts and adds an extra mount to make sure the exhaust doesn't contact anything nearby. I will say at this point, if I had ordered the larger 70mm pipe, clearance may have been an issue as there were a few spots where the exhaust was very close to metal on metal contact. That said, with all the mounts on, it was very snug in place. And now that we're finished with the install, it's time for its very first startup with the new Catback. Alright, so the install was a success and startup was a success. Always a good idea to check under the car, make sure you don't have an exhaust leak on that mating surface between the catalytic converter and the Catback, where you put in that gasket. And now it is time to move on to sound testing. So for sound testing, I have this device right here. This is an X-Tech STL600, measures and records decibel level. So I'm placing it in the center because I want to have that in between the two exhaust pipes and then the same distance from just the single exhaust pipe. So it's the exact same location for both tests, measured exactly where I placed this. And we're going to look at decibel readings at idle at 3000 RPM, 5000, 7000, and then just giving it some full throttle blips and seeing what the peak volume that it reads. So for the stock exhaust, it was about 64 decibels at idle. This is about 900-950 RPM, somewhere in that range. So 64 decibels at 3000 RPM, 75 decibels about, 5000 RPM, about 87 decibels, and 7000 RPM, we're looking at about 95 decibels. Now I did give it some full throttle blips to see what it would say, and it looks like the peak measurements were about 122 decibels. And now we can listen in on the titanium Catback testing. So at idle, we're looking at about 68 decibels, a little bit louder than idle for the stock exhaust. As you can see at 3000 RPM, we're floating around 77 decibels. At 5000 RPM, we're looking at about 88 decibels. As we get to 7000 RPM, we're looking at about 94, which is very close to the stock, but just slightly quieter. And finally, with some full throttle application, you can see it peaking at about 122 decibels. And now we'll listen a quick comparison between full throttle applications with the stock exhaust versus full throttle with the Catback exhaust. Okay, so there you have it. As far as the sound comparison, honestly, not a huge difference. A little bit of a deeper tone with the titanium Catback. Not a big difference overall, which is slightly disappointing, but I'm also glad that it doesn't sound, ricey, I guess is the best word to say. It doesn't sound like it doesn't belong on this car. It sounds very close to stock. It's just slightly more aggressive. I think it could be a little bit more, but I'm happy that it's not way too loud and not super raspy or kind of whiny or rattly like some of the exhausts that you see out there, especially on smaller four-cylinder Honda engines. Now, cool to look at is actually plotting these decibel levels with respect to time. So on the left-hand side, the axis, we have decibel. On the bottom, we have time. In blue is stock exhaust, and in green is the Catback. And, you know, you can see initially idling, and there's some peaks in there from wind and from me walking past, things like that. Then you can see the range where it's idling, and you can see the Catback in green is a little bit louder. Now, you know, I didn't actually perform these tests with the intent of comparing them side by side with respect to time, but it does turn out that they're a pretty close overlap, so it is fairly easy to look at them. You can see then as it goes up to 3000 RPM, 5000 RPM, and then finally 7000 RPM, they do stay fairly equal. And then looking at, you know, kind of flooring it and just having those throttle peaks, the green one seems to have some louder spikes in there, but overall, you know, they both peak around 120 decibels. All right, so next we have dyno testing. Moment of truth, does this exhaust actually make any more power? Okay, so here's where it's gonna get really ugly in the comments, and that's fine, I'm okay with it. But basically what happened is before, 183.5 horsepower, after installing, 186 horsepower. So, this is a $2,500 exhaust, and it made an additional 2.5 horsepower. $1,000 per horsepower, probably one of the worst investments you could ever make. And I admit that that's true, I do. But I am actually really excited about it, and I'm excited about the dyno plot because you can learn from it. And honestly, that's why I do these things. I don't do it necessarily because I think it's going to make my car amazing. I do it mostly because I want to learn. Now, is it lame that it's only 2.5 horsepower? Yes, but considering the fact that all that was changed was you took a muffler that goes in once, up, and then back down, versus a muffler that goes straight through at the exact same size, the fact that you can gain 2.5 horsepower just from that simple change is actually pretty impressive and pretty cool to see. Now, why am I confident in the dyno numbers, and how do I know, you know, how do I believe that it's actually a 2.5 horsepower increase? Well, if you look at the dyno graph, what's pretty interesting to see is that before VTEC kicks in, yo, at about 6,000 RPM, both of the torque and the horsepower lines are basically identical before and after. Flow isn't super important at these lower RPMs. There's plenty of flow through the stock exhaust, even with that bend, so it's not a big deal. Then after VTEC kicks in, yo, you can see a noticeable increase in the torque curve the entire way across. So there's a little bit of a gap the entire way across from about 6,000 RPM onwards. And as a result, power is uniformly up across that you know, range of RPM. So super cool to see, you know, this was done on the exact same dyno. No changes were made to the car except for that catback. And as you can see, once flow becomes important above 6,000 RPM, it actually does make more power with the more efficient pathway of this aftermarket exhaust. Now, how can you make more power if you actually didn't make any changes to the engine? This is certainly a question that comes up. So I changed the exhaust. It does make more power to the wheels. That is a fact. But people question that because it seems strange. All you did was change something after the engine. And so to think about it this way, so that engine has to push out those exhaust gases. And the easier of a time it has to push out those exhaust gases, the less energy it is spending pushing out those exhaust gases, so the more energy it can use to power these rear wheels. If you have something super restrictive, if you just have a little pinhole right here, your engine's gonna have to work really hard to press out those exhaust gases. That's that piston coming up, forcing out those exhaust gases. That requires work to do, so that's energy that's not going to your wheels, it's instead going to pushing that exhaust out. Well, if you open it up, if you make it easier for the car to push that exhaust gas out, then it's going to have an easier time. Doing so won't require as much energy, and as a result, you will see higher horsepower at the wheels. Very cool. Now, is it $2,500 cool? You know, I can agree with almost all of you, I'm sure, on this, and that no, it's really not. And this is a learning experiment, right? This video was done to learn. It certainly would not have been possible without autotempest.com. So thank you for stepping in, making this possible. And we, you know, we all get to see some cool data as a result. So now let's move on to the final piece of data, and that is real world acceleration testing. So the way I'm measuring real world differences before and after, I'm using this VBox Sport. It connects to about 10 to 12 satellites up in the sky, determines, you know, your exact location, and then measures time differences as you accelerate. So what I did is, you know, three runs with the stock car in second gear, only second gear, no shifting, to eliminate shifting as a variable. Second gear, we're accelerating from 10 miles per hour to 60 miles per hour. We're doing that exact same run three times, then taking the average number of those three runs in increments of 5 miles per hour. Now I will show you the summarized data here, so the average of those three runs for each of the increments which I measured. So, you know, 10 to 15 miles per hour, 15 to 20, 20 to 25, and so on. And then I did the exact same test in the exact same location, and I'll talk about some of the ambient differences, but basically exact same test, just with the catback exhaust, three runs, 10 miles per hour, second gear up to 60 miles per hour, took the average of those three runs, and then compare them side by side. Now, as a general summary, if you take the 10 mile per hour to 60 mile per hour time and compare it before and after, you're looking at 7.6 seconds with the stock exhaust and 7.30 seconds with the catback exhaust. So an improvement overall of about 5%, which is actually pretty decent considering. I mean, it's 34 pounds lighter and, you know, it's a little bit more powerful. And so as a result, you do actually measure a real world difference. Now, if we go back and look at our dyno plot, you'd probably expect to see that most of that difference was made in the higher end where it makes slightly more power. And that is slightly true. So if you look at the 10 to 35 mile per hour time, the catback exhaust is about 4.8% faster versus if you look at the 35 to 60 mile per hour time where that engine's in those higher RPM where VTEC starts to engage, it's actually 5.2% faster. So a little bit faster in the higher RPM, a little bit more performance gain in those higher RPMs rather than the lower RPM. And across the board, it's about 5% quicker. Okay, so we have a car that's 1.2% lighter and it's 1.4% more powerful. You might not expect to see a 5% power improvement. And I think this is where the ambient conditions come in. I try to do my test as close as possible, but it just doesn't always work out. And so, you know, when I did do the catback testing, it was 10 degrees Fahrenheit cooler. Pressure was also slightly higher, so both of those would help it make a little bit more power. On the flip side, humidity was over double when I tested the catback than when I tested it with the stock exhaust, so that would make a little bit less power. But overall, we see a 5% improvement basically across the board in acceleration as a result of pulling out weight, 34 pounds, and adding a bit of power to the top end, about 2.5 horsepower. So although there are, you know, environmental factors that can certainly affect it, it also does have a measurable improvement from the dyno. And as far as, you know, obviously you have removed a certain amount of weight. So this has been super exciting for me, hopefully for you as well, learning, very cool to see. If you have not yet, please check out autotempest.com. I've got a link in the video description. Thank you again, Nathan, CEO of Autotempest and fellow S2000 owner. He actually autocrosses his, super cool to see. So check out that website. Thanks again for him sponsoring the video. If you guys have any questions or comments, of course, feel free to leave those below. And if you wanna see any helpful links as far as some of the products used, things like that in the video, that will all be included in the video description. Thank you all.